The member for Newland, the member for Newland. And before I call the member for Newland, I remind the House that this is the member's first speech and that she should be accorded the normal courtesies and respect afforded to new members on this most important occasion. The member for Newland has the call.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I congratulate you on your re-election to the role. It is a great privilege also to speak after the member for Adelaide, and I congratulate her on her resounding success. It will be the greatest honour of my life to have been elected the member for Newland, and I would like to acknowledge former members for Newland, particularly Tom Kenyon and Richard Harvey, for their service to the people of the northeastern suburbs and Adelaide Hills. To Dr. Richard Harvey, the outgoing member for Newland. Richard was an incredibly warm and fair opponent in the campaign period and has been gracious and humble in defeat. Richard and I have a similar sense of humour and we've always gotten along. We, as South Australians, live in the best state in the best country on earth. Dr. Harvey and I also live in the best electorate on earth, and I believe the civility of our democratic process is a true testament to that fact. Dr. Harvey's personal kindnesses, however, are a testament to no one but himself, and I thank him for them from the bottom of my heart. I would like to congratulate Her Excellency the Governor on her opening of Parliament yesterday and thank her for her service to South Australia. Her Excellency outlined Labor's ambitious policy agenda, one that I am so proud to have campaigned for. I congratulate the Premier on his astounding success. We were elected by South Australians with a clear mandate to deliver that agenda, and that is in no small part thanks to the Premier and his steadfast leadership. On a personal note, I would like to thank both the Premier and the Deputy Premier for not only their leadership, but their warmth. I have felt supported by both Pete and Susan every day since my pre-selection, and I thank them for their unwavering endorsement of not only me, but my agenda in the northeastern suburbs. Pete and Susan are kind, compassionate, and two of my biggest fans. And to me, that is true leadership. I am so proud to be part of their team, and thank you for allowing me the privilege. The seat of Newland was created in 1976, replacing the abolished district of Tea Tree Gully. I'd also like to acknowledge the first and only member for Tea Tree Gully, who was also the first female Labor member in the South Australian Parliament, Molly Byrne. It is an incredible privilege to stand on the shoulders of a giant of not only the Labor Party, but a giant of suffrage in SA. Thank you, Molly, for your service to our state, our movement, and the people of the Gully. Newland is now an entirely metropolitan seat in the northeastern suburbs of Adelaide. We take in half of Modbury North, had to give the other half to the member for Wright, as well as Modbury, Hope Valley, St Agnes, Ridgehaven, Yatla Vale, Banksia Park, Fairview Park and Tea Tree Gully, right to the edge of the Adelaide Hills near Houghton. The entirety of the seat of Newland is in the City of Tea Tree Gully Council area and includes the Tea Tree Gully Historical Precinct. In 1907, Modbury was described as a quiet little country village with a store, machinist shop, chaff mill, Methodist church, schoolroom and hotel. In a book named The History of Tea Tree Gully, it was remarked that the reporter might have written an identical report at the end of another 50 years, as in 1957 there were still only 62 houses in Modbury. In the years that followed, our community was built. Today, there are over 7,000 houses in Modbury, and it acts as our business precinct. The Council Civic Centre was built in 1967. In 1970, Meyer Tea Tree Plaza opened. And in 1973, Modbury Hospital, our hospital, was proudly opened by Premier Don Dunstan. All three of those locations are cornerstones of our community, and all of them play a role in my story as well. Tea Tree Gully is my home. I grew up in Highbury, and today I live in St Agnes. In Year 8 and Year 9, I attended Kildare College in Holden Hill. My best friend Ashley and I spent our Thursday nights on the 506 bus to Tea Tree Plaza and our weekends at her family home in Modbury North. I got my licence at Modbury Service SA, albeit it took me multiple attempts, and I've been to Modbury Hospital for a burst appendix, a concussion, and not one, but three anaphylactic reactions. My brothers learnt to swim at Paragon Swimming Centre, which is still right next door. Through uni, I worked at 42nd Street Cafe, Tetree Plaza, which became my second home. Throughout the campaign, I was reunited with so many of my old customers, and even on polling day, had not one, but three residents tell me that they recognised me, not from the campaign, but from serving them at the plaza some 8 years ago. In 2018, I was elected as a ward councillor for Balmoral Ward in the city of Tetree Gully. Balmoral Ward includes Newland suburbs of Modbury, Hope Valley and St Agnes, and I thank those residents who have continued to support me from my council campaign. I am lucky to have had the support of Tetree Gully Council staff and councillors throughout the campaign as well, and thank CEO John Moyle, as well as my former colleagues and elected members. Particular thanks goes to Deputy Mayor Lucas Jones, his wife Chloe and my surrogate niece Charlotte. Lucas, you have taken me in from the day we first started working together at the Newland electorate office and made me part of your family. I thank you for your support. My time on council gave me a particular understanding and appreciation for the Tetree Gully CWMS network. The city is home to 4,700 septic tanks with around 76 different systems of septic pipework. Out of the 4,700 tanks, roughly 4,000 of those are in Newland. I was recently gifted a book from a resident named From Settlement to City, A History of the District of Tetree Gully by Ian All. The book was gifted to me by John and Pat Wilson, local authors from Fairview Park, and I thank them for joining me online today. The book was published in 1976 and discusses the issues of deep drainage, common effluent and sewerage in Tetree Gully. 46 years post-publication, we are transitioning the Tetree Gully CWMS network to SA Water Management. It was Labor who fully committed and first committed to a transition to SA Water, and only Labor who ever committed to scrap the CWMS levy. On the 1st of July this year, thousands of residents in the seats of Newland, Wright and Moriarty will no longer pay a $745 service charge to the council for their septic services. Our government will continue to deliver the sustainable sewers project for our community. It is by far my proudest commitment. It's one that affects over a third of electors in the seat. Residents have been on the CWMS network for upwards of 40 years. There are septic tanks in people's bedrooms, under their swimming pools, and at one beautiful house that I door-knocked in Banksia Park, at the bottom of a creek beneath a bamboo forest. I thank the Tetree Gully councillors for their work on this issue, as well as the CWMS Action Group, particularly Rose Morton and Adela Matiski, for their years of continued advocacy. I come from a long line of strong, independent women. Each one of those women has been a single mum with an insecure job, with insecure housing, and lived with the traumas of mental illness, addiction, domestic violence, and sexual abuse. Despite all of that, each one of those women is loud, intelligent, vivacious, hardworking, charismatic, and best of all, inherently political. In our family, we do not let our experiences define us. We were bred to be fighters, and no one tells us what to do. Today, I thank my village of strong women. In particular, my mum, Rachel Koopmans, my nan, Sarah Courtney, who joins us today, my aunties, Catherine Zengara and Fiona Killick McKinnon, and my cousins, Isabel Zengara, who also joins us, and Courtney Oswald. I also thank Matthew Zengara and Stuart Henderson for often being the sole males in a pack of very strong, loud women. My family means the world to me. My mum is no stranger to adversity. When I was three, my mum and stepfather were married. My younger brother, Benjamin Isaac Koopmans, was born on the 24th of September 2000 at 24 weeks gestation. He was born awake, but later that day died in my mother's arms. His death changed the course of our lives entirely, and I say his name today for the record to acknowledge in this place the identities of babies born still and the gap left in families like mine by their passing. His death shaped my childhood, and unfortunately, my memories of being a four-year-old are somewhat tarnished by memories of alcoholism and domestic violence that followed. At one stage, my mum, my older brother and I moved into a shelter run by the Lutheran Church. I still remember getting ready for my first transition day to reception at the shelter, and my brother telling me that I couldn't tell the other kids where we were living. Many of my beautiful cousins have also lived with the perils of addiction. My mum and my beautiful auntie Bianca acted as kinship carers to my cousins on and off for many years. I worry every day about their opportunities post those placements in foster care, residential care, and kinship care. I know I cannot change their circumstances and I cannot write their stories for them, but I can stand in this place, even when it's incredibly difficult, and use my experiences to guide my decision making. I am a member of the Australian Labor Party because I believe in equal opportunity no matter your circumstances, and I will fight for those equal opportunities for the rest of my life. My mum is the pillar of that belief system. She has taught me always that our experiences should not dictate our opportunities and that our traumas do not define our worth. My mum has chased every single one of her goals. She is smart, she is dedicated, and she would do anything for anyone. She is a small business owner, a theologian, an archaeologist, a collector of any bird that flies into her garden, and the life of any dance floor. To Mum, you are the strongest person I know. At times you have suffered greatly, but you light up every room with your charm, wit, and enormous heart for others. You have made me strong, and that hasn't always been easy, but I owe you so much and love you dearly. To my dad, Michael Savvas. My dad is a truly gifted academic and wordsmith. He makes everything sound beautiful. My dad brings magic to everything he touches. He finds beauty in the otherwise banal and can make anything into an adventure. If my dad finds out something strange is happening, he has to be there for it, which makes him the best and most interesting person you'll ever meet. My dad has been known to watch court proceedings for fun and to set out on the solo task of solving otherwise unsolved mysteries. He's smart, he's dry, he's charismatic, and he's my very best friend. Weekends with my dad and my sisters were always like a holiday. My dad is the dad who took us for outings to the Elizabeth Ageing Festival and the Kilburn Dog Show, making sure every weekend with him was filled with activities. He made incredible sacrifices for me and my sisters and continuously pushes us to be the best versions of ourselves. My dad is my biggest fan, and our connection is so special. It brings me great sadness to know we're not joined by my grandma today, Carlene Savvas, but I feel her presence in everything we do together, Dad, and I hope that you do too. To my stepdad, David Koopmans. When I think of you, I think of Neil Young playing in the back shed at Windsor Gardens or teaching me the words to Chucky's In Love by Ricky Lee Jones on the drive home down Grand Junction Road. You were the one who took me to McDonald's every Friday for a small fries reward if I got 10 out of 10 on my spelling test, to which I always did, and the one who stayed up late into the night helping me study for my Year 12 exams. You have always told me how proud you are of me. You have been affronted by a terrible affliction, and that at times has been unspeakably hard. But I want you to know that I think of you with nothing but love. To my siblings, Michael, Zachary and Elijah Koopmans, and Chelsea and Taylor Fernandez. Nothing makes me prouder than being your big sister. My brothers and sisters are the most important people in my life, and every day they continue to marvel me with their intellect and their strength. I love you all dearly, and I thank Chelsea for joining us today. To my extended family on my dad's side, most notably my great auntie Leslie Murphy, who joined me yesterday, and Uncle Bob Murphy. They have taken me in as a surrogate granddaughter and never looked back. To my cousins, Robin and Chris Hambor, and their kids, Grace and Henry, and to Beck and Steve Murphy, and their kids, Sarah, Zach, Billy, and my beautiful goddaughter, Abby, thank you for your love and your laughter. There are a number of people I'd like to thank from my second family, the South Australian branch of the ALP. I first got involved in Labor as a bright-eyed 17-year-old at the 2013 federal election. I officially joined the party in October 2015 and I have never looked back. To Reggie Martin, Eamon Burke, John Bistrovic, Rick Morris and the entire team at CHQ, winning an election off a first-time government is no easy feat, and your team ran an incredible, united, relatable campaign. I thank you all for your tireless efforts and unending support. To all my parliamentary colleagues in both places, I thank you. From the other place, I'd like to make particular mention to Emily Burke for her love and friendship over many years, Claire Scriven for all her support, as well as Tung No for personally letterboxing half of my electorate with addressed mail. In this place, I congratulate each of the newly elected members on both sides, especially to the members for Elder, Waite, Davenport, Gibson, Adelaide and King. I also would like to mention Michael Brown, Zoe Bettison and Lee Odenwalder for their assistance during the campaign. To Nick Champion. For 2.5 years, I sat in the front desk of your federal electorate office in Manapara. Not too many years later, we stand here together as colleagues in state parliament. Nick, I will never be able to thank you enough for everything you did to ensure I could enter this place. You had so much faith in me when I had little to no faith in myself. You are a true friend, and I thank you. To Blair Boyer and his beautiful family. Blair has spent the last 8 months campaigning across not one, but three marginal seats. Well, at least he referred to Wright as marginal, though the verdict's out on that one. But also doing everything he could to ensure the northeastern suburbs were back in Labor hands. I'm so proud to see you become a minister and so lucky to have had you on my team. To the newly minted member for King, Rhiannon Pearce. Not many people get to go to work every day with their very best friend, but I get to 7 days a week. Rhiannon started as a colleague and became a sister. She is the most selfless person I know. She checks in every day and never complains about herself. Just this morning, she texted at about 7 a.m, randomly offering to go to the chemist and pick up some medicine for my nerves. She's fun, she's fearless, and she's a bit of a dag. The people of King are lucky to have her represent them, and I'm lucky to have her in my life. To my federal colleagues, particularly Senator Marielle Smith, Amanda Rishworth, and Tony Zappia, I thank you for all your support and your advice over the campaign period. To Senator Don Farrell and Nympha Farrell, I thank you both for your service to our state and our movement over many decades. Senator, I am incredibly cognizant of your role in the Labor Party and thank you for paving the way for so many others. Your personal support of me means the world. Nympha, you have a heart of gold and I'm so lucky to have you in my corner. Thank you for joining me today. To the Newland campaign team, Peter Gatenbeek, Alex Pados, Suzanne Kellett, Eloise Atterton, Julian Cox, Sean Hill, Victoria Brown, Michaela Wangman, and many others. Every day of the Newland campaign, I was astounded by the incredible belief you all had in me and the lengths you were willing to go for our cause. Peter Gatenbeek. It was nothing short of a privilege to have been given you as my campaign manager. Over the last 8 months, you managed my campaign, as well as my personal life, social calendar and occasional emotional outbursts. Managing a marginal seat campaign with an 8-month lead time is no easy feat. And the work you put in, particularly in those first few weeks of my pre-selection, was flawless. Every day I woke up in awe of the work you were doing for me and for our movement. In fact, for the majority of the campaign, I felt quite guilty for not working anywhere near as hard as you were, and feeling as if I didn't take on the burdens of the campaign in the way that you did. I now know that that's because you weren't letting me, and I thank you for that. Running in a three-corner race without an 18-month campaign, like the other marginal seats, we often felt the odds were against us. Despite that, we were always on the same side, and you always told me you knew we could do it. Whenever anyone asks if we worked well together, I answer by saying this. We did not have a single argument from my pre-selection to election day. That is not a testament to me, because there were certainly times where I was worth arguing with, but to you, an indicative of your enduring patience and commitment to our goal. Everything fazed me in the campaign period, so your response was to let nothing outwardly faze you. I will always remember a particularly stressful campaign meeting in Parliament House. I was really struggling with the enormity of the task ahead. You took me across to La Mocha for a coffee and sat with me while I cried. You showed me immense kindness for a minute or two, and after I finished my coffee, I remember you distinctly saying, "You're okay now, go knock on some doors." That's Pete, all hard work and no fuss. Pete, you are an asset to our group and we are all better for knowing you. I wish you so much goodness in your career and would like to offer a special congratulations to yourself and beautiful Millie for your wedding a few weeks ago. In addition to taking on a marginal seat campaign, you were planning a wedding, and I'm so glad Millie still likes me even so. Thank you both for being here with me today. To Alex Paddos, you are one of a kind. You are the most loyal soldier I've ever had the pleasure of knowing, and I hope that every late night spent doing mail-outs and exporting data in a very particular way was worth it. Not only so that we could see Newland represented in this place, but so that each and every door-knocking letter I sent out was addressed to the household's dog. I met many a constituent at the pre-poll and on election day who thanked me on behalf of their dog for those letters. So from me and those dogs, I thank you. To Sean Hill, you are bright, strategic, and have the biggest heart for working people of anyone I know. Sean is the kind of guy who will message you out of the blue just to tell you he thinks you're brilliant. He has an incredible eye for detail and ran my core fluting expedition with military precision. Sean, I thank you for your friendship and your tireless work in the Labor movement. To Ben Rillo. Anyone who knows Ben knows he's incredibly dedicated, unbelievably hardworking, and a brilliant strategic political mind. More significant than that, however, is his painstaking loyalty. Ben puts himself second to the needs of the party always and seeks no recognition or reward. I truly believe that our branch of the ALP is a better place because we have a loyal soldier like Ben in our membership, and I am incredibly lucky to have him in my corner as not only a colleague, but one of my very best friends. So Ben, I thank you. To Jennifer Allison, the sort of friend who shows up at 8 p.m. with a bag of groceries and stays listening to you complain until 3 a.m. on a Wednesday morning. Jen calls every day. It doesn't matter what's going on in her own life, she will always find the time to check in with me. At Christmas time, when I was struggling more than ever, she bought me a print entitled "Sunshine After the Rain." Jen loves and loves and loves, and I think of Jen as my personal sunshine on hard days, so thank you. To Tara Fatehi, particular thanks goes to you and your family for acting as a Corflute home base for many months. Tara, you are selfless, you are fierce, you are strong, and you are brilliant. I hope one day to see you in a place like this one. To a number of Labor women who have backed me from day one, I cannot name you all, but thank Megan Spencer, the true definition of a woman who backs a woman. Amy Ware, Sarah Hugh, Ella Shaw and many others. I can't wait to see where the movement takes you all. To my staff, Sav Lee, Yulian Cox and Ella Corcoran, thank you for bearing with me in the transition period. I'm looking forward to see what we can do and what we can achieve in Newland over the next few months. A number of my personal friends provided both campaign support and emotional support throughout the campaign too. To Ashley Bradshaw, you are a sister to me and my biggest ally. I wouldn't have gotten through the last 8 months without you, and I will be forever grateful. To Elizabeth Stankevichus, Sam Green, Isabel Bolin, Julia Shankalapore, Edwina Lane, Kira Fanning-Walsh, Jack Dart, Lucy Loken and Miranda Traeger, I thank you for not giving up on our friendships, even when I was absent. I can't assure you all that I all of a sudden have more free time, but I can assure you that I'm incredibly grateful to have you in my life, and I'll try my best. Finally, to the union movement. To the Transport Workers Union and the Financial Services Union, who supported me during my very short period in the corporate sector, I give my thanks to TWU Secretary Ian Smith and FSU Secretary Jason Hall. Next, to my union and the union of over 200,000 retail and fast food workers across Australia. Working in the union movement grounds a person in a certain kind of way. It taught me not only the value of secure, well-paid work, but instilled in me the inherent dignity of the opportunity to access stable working conditions. Throughout my life, my relatives have fought their way through insecure jobs. Almost every person on my mum's side of the family have relied on Centrelink at one time or another and tried their hand at casual work or insecure contracts for short periods of time and little pay. Permanent secure work was a foreign concept to me, as was home ownership. My mum being the first and only person in her family before me to have purchased a home. Not only did working at the SDA teach me about the dignity of secure work through our members, but it gave me dignity in what I did as well. Before I worked at the SDA, I was working 30 hours a week in hospitality for $10 an hour. I was studying full-time and often struggling with my subjects, unable to keep up with uni, having to pay my own way, and often being unable to pay for petrol, car registration and my phone bill. The SDA gave me a job and they gave me a chance. They gave me dignity in my profession and the opportunity to be more than I thought I could be. Becoming a union rep at the age of 20 defined the rest of my career. I had a secure, well-paid job, and because of that, the ability to succeed. They supported me then, and they continue to support me now. And I would like to thank Josh Peak, Sonia Romeo, Tom Carrick-Smith, and the entire SANT branch of the Shop Distributive and Allied Employees Association for giving me the great privilege of joining the Shoppies family. Without that family, I would not be standing in this place. And I thank them for everything they've done for me and the retail, fast food and warehousing workers across the state. Today, I stand beneath a tapestry celebrating women's suffrage and can see the words, as mentioned by the member for Adelaide, a woman's place is in the house. I am incredibly cognizant of the privilege to be the youngest woman ever elected to this place and the responsibility that comes with that privilege. I am someone who often feels she had to grow up too early. I would do anything to go back and tell a very scared 4-year-old girl that in 21 short years she would be a Member of Parliament, but I cannot. Instead, I will make it my mission to tell every other young boy and girl that no matter their circumstances or their postcode, that they can. So to the many young girls and boys who have shown an interest in my campaign, this is for you. To Amelia of Tea Tree Gully, who made it her mission to meet not only the three Newland candidates, but the Premier as well. to Shub of St Agnes, who made a Labour Corps flute in his Year 4 class, to Emily of St Agnes, who felt she could run for school president because I was elected, to Susanna of St Agnes, who made me a picture that said, "Olivia is the government." To Patrick of Tea Tree Gully, who asked me to ask the Premier and Scott Morrison if we can have three-day weekends. To Alia of Tea Tree Gully, who wrote to me saying, "I'm glad Labor won. I know with more hospital beds we will have a good state." To each and every one of you and every other young person in this state who wants to represent their community, you can, no matter where you come from, and I promise to do everything in my power to ensure that you do. Thank you.